All right, so we've been comparing and contrasting Google and Bing with a basic keyword search. And you might see that each one of them gives you slightly different
We've got the
results.
whole social media thing going. Oh,
Speaking
excuse
now.
us.
And each of them gives you slightly different results here. And so one of the things you might have noticed, some of you get a result in, like this, and some of you don't. You might see something that looks like this, where it looks like a really nice, graphic that shows you on a location and such. That would be nice for my business to show up like that. So we'll talk about that also. But the short answer to this is that if you also have your business set up on Google Local, for example, I believe they call it Google Places, and then also on Bing, it's got their own local thing. So if your business is a business that has a physical location, you can look into the search engines. How do I put myself on a map? Because this is enticing me more to click on than these guys over here. Maybe this company over here is good, but when I see a name over here like Bok Design and a little map and in directions and stuff, it entices me to click on that more. That is a bit more of the setup of you going in and researching Google Places and Bing Local and such.
Does Google have charges for if you have maps and all that stuff?
No, actually, the basic aspect of it doesn't charge for it. They make their money off of like the ads and such, if you choose to get ads. Now, we're going to deal with the long tail keyword strategy. Let me show you an example of that. That would be another term for that. Let me write down here. We're going to engage in long tail keyword strategy. It's also might be called natural language query, all these fancy terms. Let me show you what that is in practical purposes. What's a good local taco shop? All right, I asked my phone with a natural language query. I asked it like a regular person. I didn't think of asking it like a machine, taco shop 91912 reviews. I asked it like a regular person, and then it responded like a regular person. And the results here on my screen show me, because it knows where I'm at, GPS, it knows in the general location, these are some possible taco shops. These are all within 1 mile distance. And when I said, what's a good one? Well, the way it tells me what's a good one is with Yelp results, Yelp reviews. So the number one result here, El Esmeralda's Taco Shop, less than 1 mile away, 4 stars. La Fuente Mexican Food, 1 mile away, 4 stars. 109 Yelp reviews. Lolita's Taco Shop, 1,695 Yelp reviews, 4 stars. So this is the long tail keyword strategy, using more natural language, using more detail, basically. You've probably done it yourself too without thinking about it. The websites have been around 27 years. They were basically invented in 1989. Yes, the internet is older. That's from the 60s and such. That's a diff the internet is all the computers connected in the world. The websites are websites that we visit with a web browser, 1989. And you've probably used websites for what? 2 years, 5 years, 10 years, 15 years, 20 years? You've used websites for a while. And you probably use search engines. And you've probably figured out by yourself that if I simply search that's not a great result. What if instead I had searched for web design 91914? Or what if I searched for affordable web design 91914? That's doing that same sort of thing where I'm doing this natural language search where I'm being more specific. And that, in essence, is the long tail keyword strategy, being more specific. Long tail keyword strategy, being more specific. In short, being more specific. Putting in more keywords, sure. Putting in a real question, like you might have done this. I just did this previously with someone. I typed in, what version of Flash do I have? So I asked it like a question, and then it gave me an answer. If I was doing that also again for the taco shop. So what if I do the same thing here? What if I do now, let's do this on Google. Let's try the long tail. Let's try an actual question, such as, I'm going to do, I don't know, authentic Italian food restaurant in Chula Vista. So I'm focusing on a specific location, Chula Vista. Although these things are smarter and smarter, on the one hand, also scarier, that they know where I'm searching from. Why didn't it give me results a moment ago of design studios in New York? It knows I'm in San Diego. Well, here I specifically said Chula Vista, Italian food. I said authentic, because I don't really want to eat over at Olive Garden. So here, then I get these results. I get a really nice result page with a map. I get regular results, text results that maybe don't catch my attention, like a nice picture and stars and such. And so the top result here, these are also not paid results. These are basically that these companies have set up a free profile over at Google Places, a Google business page. It's free if you took the social media class last month. We talked about that. We'll talk about it again when the class rolls around again. But basically, this is creating a Google Plus profile, a Google Plus business page, or getting on Yelp and such. So the number one result in this case, actually, is my client. Italianissimo Trattoria is a client that we have. They're in Chula Vista. They have very good reviews right there, 4.6 stars. Right down the street, Mangia Italiano. They have more reviews, but less stars. And then Olive Garden, they've got lots of reviews and not the best. Yes?
Do companies hire to get reviews?
That's the question that people always ask about, how trustworthy is Yelp and how trustworthy is Kudzu and all of that. There is, to some degree, it's good that you have the skepticism, to some degree that there's shenanigans. But the business of Yelp and all of these companies is to try to put these reviews that are accurate and put the best out there, because you're not going to trust Yelp if you find out yet another expose that all the reviews are fake. So there are, to some degree, fake ones, and companies do pay for reviews and companies do bribe for reviews. The more this is in the spotlight, the better they get at it. But here's my trick. Look at reviews, and the more reviews, the more accurate. If it's 3 reviews, 7 reviews, 10 reviews, those could have all been paid for. If it's getting to be 20 reviews, 50 reviews, 100 reviews, 1,000 reviews, those are much more accurate. Out of here, 20, 20, and 50, you know, it's a good amount of reviews. I could conceivably say, yeah, they paid for 10 of those reviews. I know personally from this company, no, they did not pay for it. I don't know about these guys. But the thing about any of these review sites, the way you can be more skeptical about it is the more reviews, the more accurate. And there are some still that are going to be fake, but Yelp does try its best to put out, to take away the fake ones.
Yelp will say something like, a 20-year-old woman from this area made a review or something like that.
Well, it'll tell you, if a person doesn't want to identify themselves, it'll say it's that generic info. But if a person really identifies themselves, because people, for fun or profit, create accounts on Yelp and become like hardcore Yelp reviewers. And they earn the distinction, a top Yelper, 2015. So people, for pride or whatever, want to review for real, and therefore they don't want their reviews deleted, they're going to review for real. And so there's the good and the bad about it, but these review sites really are the valuable ones nowadays. Now, this particular client, again, they're number one right there. They appear on the map here. That's nice. Let's say I think this is an ad. I'm going to skip it. So I'm going to not look at any of these. Well, I'm going to look at these results over here. That client is also number one. But notice the client's website is number one, is not number one. The Yelp is number one. This is to show you again the importance of SEM. What else are you doing besides your website? Are you on Yelp? Are you also on Twitter? Are you on Facebook? Are you active on Instagram? Whatever. Are you doing stuff besides your website? Because with so much competition, especially in restaurants and service industries and such, more and more is being relied upon the ratings, the reviews, the testimonials. So the client's website is not number one, but this is still a triumph. This is still a win. Number one result is still that client, which people will click on, which people will read and say, okay, maybe they're good. Maybe that great review is warranted out of 306 reviews. Let's say half of them are fake. That's still 150 real reviews. Great photos and so forth. And then, of course, link back to the website. So even if they go over, if they go wander off to Yelp or Facebook or whatever, always have a link back to your website. Then there's best Italian food, another Yelp review, another Yelp. And then the fourth result is the client's actual website. And then the competitor down the street, TripAdvisor, and then the competitor down the other side of the street is down there. Literally, three Italian food restaurants on one street. And then the yellow pages, you know, we don't want the yellow pages on our doorstep anymore, but they're still around and there's still a presence on the web. And then Zomato, it's another sort of review site. OpenTable, to book a table. It's the competitor, they're actually over in East Lake and they're closed. But they come up here, one of the valuable slots was taken up by a closed location. But still, this client is number one. If you discount these over here, if you think they're ads, they're still number one over here, thanks to Yelp, and their own website is also higher than the competition. Notice the competition really doesn't have any of these other ancillary results. I'm going to do the same search just to compare it over for Bing. Number one result, Luca Di Beppo.
Yay.
It's the best of the best, right?
Fun.
And then over here, oh, there's the client right there. So even these guys that paid, these guys did not pay. The owner, bless his heart, but he's a big cheapskate, he hired us. He hired us and we made him a website, but besides that, he didn't really pay for very much else. We made him a great website. And really, on this example, the food speaks for itself. The food being reviewed on Yelp and such, and look right here, Bing is giving them this big, beautiful, free hero image. H-E-R-O, hero image. This big image here with their own little call-out box with directions and a website, of course, and the menu, which is on the website. Yes?
If people even click on it, I see those ads in the chat, but they just pay for that.
Again, you may not do so. All your friends and family don't do so, but there's still millions and hundreds of millions of people that will click on it that, for some people, they see the very, very first result, don't see that it says an ad, and click. Or do see that it's an ad and still don't understand it, and then click anyway. So we want to hit all the people that are less savvy, that are not going to know about or care that it's an ad, the people that are savvy that are going to avoid all of these, because I might think it's an ad, and even if you avoid the ad, there they are again, etc.
How did they decide to give them the hero space?
Because of all of the things besides the website that this client has. They're ranked very well on Yelp. They're also ranked well on TripAdvisor. We do a little bit of Twitter. You know, it's getting more facets. It's finding more things to rank it.
So the algorithm looks at all these different locations.
Yeah.
And then that hits a certain number and they say, okay.
Yeah, and the thing, though, unfortunately, is a lot of this stuff is trade secrets.
Yeah.
We're not going to know about every nuance of the algorithm. We're going to try as much as we can, and we're going to follow their rules, but there's still always going to be some trade secrets, because once Bing reveals, do this, this, and this, Google will borrow it. Once Google reveals something, Bing will borrow it, and Yahoo will borrow it, and they'll all use the algorithm. So there are a bunch of trade secrets that we never really will know, but there are techniques that the search engines will tell us directly to do and not to do, and we will also go look at trade journals and websites that they will tell us what seems to work and what doesn't.
So where does it get that picture?
Let's
and then
see.
Resizes it or something?
Yeah, these pictures down here, for example,
are from
the website.
Tells you there.
So on this particular case, it is coming from the website. It might come from the Yelp. So that's why you want a good website also with good content. You want to put also your pictures on your Yelp. You want to have your pictures on Twitter.
So it's building that carousel, that slider from on its own?
Yeah.
Okay, from all the images.
Like this one here. Someone put this on Yelp.
Followed.
And so it borrowed it from Yelp. I'm sure if we kind of do the same thing over on Google, if I look at more places, this will also see a bunch of pictures. Click on that client. Here's pictures. There is a street view, so it took their street view photo. But what about those 15
photos?
Those
15 photos, that was, okay. So they're just from various places.
Yeah, like that one seems, so this person took the photo and uploaded it somewhere, because now you can also do reviews on Google itself, not just Yelp and such. So if I've got an Android phone and I check into the location and give a quick review and snap a photo of my picture like that, you know, you're basically giving all this stuff for free over to Google, and then they're using it.
Okay.
Yes.
If you put a lot of photos on Yelp, does it do anything about, is it hard to upload them, or does it take too long?
No, it's pretty easy. You create your profile on Yelp, or you claim your business on Yelp, and there'll be a box there. Once you verify that you're the legitimate owner, there'll be a button there that says upload picture. So it is pretty easy to do
so
it that way.
So what I'm saying is 20 better than 50 photos?
Sure, it doesn't hurt. It's just that it's more pictures. I don't think it's a very, very big signal that the search engine looks at. Oh, this company's got 20 pictures, this one's got two, we'll rank them better. That's one of the many signals that it looks at. So that all of those pictures are a little bit more to help your customers decide, do I want to actually go there? The food looks good. Yes?
I was wondering, do you know these little, like, it's a picture tag, do you know about this? Do you create those both for your website or just for your personal things? I mean, you know, if you're making a comment somewhere, and really my question is, would that help you move up?
The comments, adding comments on websites is helpful. We'll see that. As for what to put on that little Gravatar picture, that's a good one. I haven't fully thought about it, but it's like basically any traffic that you get from someone else's website is helpful. So if I create a Gravatar picture of the business and then I go off to someone's website and comment on their website, that's a link back to my website. So there is a value to that. As for what pictures to use, it's probably one of the many signals, so it wouldn't hurt to have a picture of your business. Rather, you know, these over here, that's a terrible picture. You know, I can't tell what that is at all.
They should have put the logo there. There's the logo of the business. It's a little more readable.
So having your logo of your business on these graphics is helpful because it helps people, you know, remember your business. That looks just like a building, but that's the business. Yes?
The little bar chart showing the times when it's busy, is that from when pictures are loaded up?
No, that's from people actually visiting the actual location, because this is coming from the, let me see, this is either coming from Yelp or it's coming from Google Places. So Google is trying to be in competition with Yelp. Yelp is the big review site. You can also give reviews on Google, you can give reviews on Facebook. They're both trying to take on Yelp. So on an Android, or on an iPhone too, I can go to the location and I can click check in, and I've checked into the business, and I've told Google I'm there.
And so Google is amassing that information. People are giving that away, and they're saying, well, it looks like more people are showing up there, are checking in at that time, less at 2 o'clock, most at 6 o'clock.
Well, when people check in on Facebook, would that link to it also?
It might not show up here, but it does show up over on Facebook, because Facebook is taking on Google as well. Facebook has got its own version of search, and its own version of Yelp, and its own version of, they just activated a new, their own version of Periscope, which is the video sharing site. So Facebook is trying to do its own versions of these things. So if you're on Facebook, you will see, oh, this place is mostly open at this time, and it's dead at this time, and I see most people checking in at that time. So I don't think that Facebook stuff goes over here, because they're rivals. They hate each other. Mm-hmm. Google and Facebook, you don't really see that much Facebook content. You see Yelp content, you see Google Plus content, but not as much Facebook content. All right, so this kind of, this is the long tail keyword strategy. This is people are going to search for in more detail what they really want. Italian food restaurant. Possibly you're not going to get found. It's going to give results of all of these downtown San Diego results. Here I've specified location, and I got a little bit more detailed. And I could have also asked Cortana. I've got a Windows phone, so I'd ask Cortana. You ask Siri, you ask Google, whatever. You ask it like a natural question. The point of this is, the next activity we'll do here is, well, we need to develop our keywords. We need to put together a list of 5 or 10 or 20 or whatever of these possible keywords that people are going to search for. Once we've accumulated this list, then we'll talk about applying them to the website. Because it's still about the content. All of these tricks about, all of these signals, all of these techniques about, yeah, Yelp, yes, and Twitter, yes, and all of that, it still goes back down to content. What is the content that you are creating online for the search engines to find to rank you when someone searches? So we're going to build a keyword list in a moment with a handout that I'll give you. But first, let's make a note here. The three pillars of SEO. Three things that you're going to build on top of. The first one is authority. I'm sorry, the first one is longevity. Next, authority. And next, content. Longevity. How long have you existed online? Authority. Why should you rank better than the rest in content? What's the stuff you are publishing to the web? Three big concepts to think about when you pull back the curtains of all of this stuff: longevity, authority, content. So, the search engines give some preference more to a website that has existed online longer. If my competitor and I both have a web design company, but she created hers a year before me, that's one of the things that'll help her rank better. It's not the only thing, of course. But one of the things is, the longer your website exists, the better. Because any spammer can create 10 websites right now, and in 2 hours, and next week. But you created your website, and you've had it for 6 months, 9 months, 12 months, 5 years, 10 years. You've had a presence that has existed longer than the spammers, because there's lots of spam online. These search engines have to change their algorithm all the time, because there's so much spam. And one of the things it sees is websites that have existed longer are better than those that haven't. And I'm not saying go off and buy a website right now. There's still other things we need to talk about. But the longer your website exists, the longer your online presence exists, you know, the longer your Facebook has been around, your YouTube, the better. There's no way for you to change that. My website was created last year. That's it. I cannot change it. Somehow I cannot trick them that it was actually published 5 years ago. Well, then we have these two other things that we can work with. If you're never going to be older than your competitor, here's two more things we can do to beat your competitor. Authority. the search engines are going to rank websites better that are more authoritative. And this one really ties into content. So let me jump to content first. Content is the stuff that you're publishing. Those blog posts, those tweets, those PDFs, you know, content, your stuff, not just your website. That's it. You've only got a website. You're not on Twitter. You're not doing emails. You're not blogging. The more of it you do, the better. The more content that you put out there into the world, into the web, the better, because the search engines can find that content. And as you keep publishing more tweets and more articles and putting more products and such online about your business, the more you're building authority. The more the search engines are seeing your stuff to show, okay, you know what you're talking about. This is a good web design company. And that will help, these two will help solve your problem of longevity. If you're going to build your website next month, you'll still be able to rank well if you address the issues of authority and content, specifically content. You build authority from content. And both of those displace what you might not have in longevity. So we'll be talking about all of this stuff. Day one is really like all of these concepts that are filling your head. And then as the class goes on, we'll do these things in detail. Any questions so far? I've got a new handout for you. I'm going to give you another handout, and you can print it on the next break. But I'm going to give you another handout now, and this is where we get in, where we get into detail about two things: the long tail keyword strategy and the competitor analysis, because that's also important to do. What's the competition doing? What are they doing right? What can I do better? What are they doing wrong? What can I do better? That'll also help inform my long tail keyword strategy. And before I show you that, let me make a quick drawing right here. Why is it called the long tail keyword strategy? I'm going to make a little, a simple little chart here. This is a basic XY chart. On the vertical, we have frequency. So up and down, the y-axis is frequency. Horizontally, x is keyword. And then here, I'm going to draw something that looks like this. That sort of keeps just tapering off smaller and smaller like that. So what this is saying is there are some keywords, so these are possible keywords. There are some keywords that are used a lot of frequency. Web design, a lot of people are searching for it and using it. A lot of people, a lot of websites are using web design. And therefore, I'm a needle in a haystack. We saw millions of results with the basic keyword of web design. It's used too much. I'm not going to get found. Further down here is the long tail. Restaurant web designers in San Diego. Being more specific, writing longer keyword search. Less people are using that keyword. Because literally, not everyone is a web designer doing websites for restaurants in Chula Vista. So less people are using a keyword over here. This is the long tail. It trails off over here. It never really goes to zero. I suppose it could, but we don't want those terms. We want terms here that less people are using on their website so that we can get found by the niche of people that are searching for us. Again, just simply, you know, highly rated, if I ask my phone, highly rated taco shops nearby. It's not going to give me taco shops in Ramona. I don't want those. I'm not going to drive that far. I want one nearby. So there's going to be smaller competition nearby. And I want it highly rated. So it's going to give me the ones with 5 stars, 4 stars. So this is the long tail keyword strategy, visualized. Keywords that are more specific than simply the generic keywords. And I'll put this graphic into the network folder in a little while. That's the long tail keyword strategy. As you see right here, if you further draw the graph, on this side over here is a cow, and then there's its tail. So I've got a handout for you. I've got another handout for you. If you open your computer window, minimize everything and go back to the desktop, open computer window, you'll see then the network location drive Z, as in zebra. Double-click classroom data drive Z. Then you will see alphabetically, if you scroll down to Campus, I've got a folder here, Campus SEO. Open that one. And I've got a brand new document for you. Drag this to your desktop or flash drive. Campus SEO number 1, long tail strategy. I'm going to have other ones numbered with different numbers as the course goes on. But this one, drag it to your desktop. The printer's off, so you can print it later. Drag it to your desktop or flash drive. And then we'll look at this activity. Did everyone find that file? Anyone need a little help finding it? I'll drag that document over to your desktop. Let's open it. Forming a long tail keyword strategy. What does your brand offer? Now, again, the terminology that I use in these classes is business, company, product, but what we talk about applies to anything. Let's say you've got a nonprofit organization. You want donations, you want volunteers. This still applies. You want to get found. What about if you've got a website where you're selling your watercolor paintings? This still applies. What if you want to learn this to sell this as a service to companies? This still applies. So I'm going to be using business and product terminology over and over, but this applies to any kind of business. What does your brand offer? Nowadays, search engines don't rank your site very well unless you have good content. It's not just about simple keywords anymore. You're not going to be found when people search Italian restaurants. You will have a better chance of being found by authentic Italian food in Chula Vista. So it's about the long tail of keywords. If you understand your niche better, you'll be able to potentially rank better. In this activity, you'll define your long tail keywords with a little bit of competitor analysis. And notice I'm using the hedge words again. Better chance of, able to potentially rank better. So I can't say, do this and you will succeed. It's still going to depend on your competition. It may be very hard to get into that top 10 of web designers, even if I get very specific. There's so much competition. So these two here, the old way, the new way, we're going to do these together. Not completely, and again, this is not homework. You don't have to do this and turn it in and you won't get a grade or anything like that. But you can do this, and I can look it over if you'd like, and I'll give you opinions and such. But we're going to do two kinds of searches. The old way, generic keywords, and the new way, long tail, which will help us to compile our terms. And the way we'll do this is you can either just write it down on paper, but I recommend instead that we'll write it in Word so that we can copy and paste. Let's go to your Start menu, and down there, Search for Word. Open up Word 2013. We're going to take some notes in Word. So search here, click Start and Search Word, and you should see Word 2013. Sure, yeah, that's a good idea too. If you want to use Google Docs online and such, you can do so too. All right, so I'm just pulling up something where I can write something. Before we go further, these computers have software called Deep Freeze. That means that when you restart the computer, when you come back next week, whatever you write and save onto the desktop or wherever will be gone. If you don't take this with you, you're going to lose it. We have to have that software on our computers because what if someone catches a virus on that computer? We just restart it and it's fine. What if someone defaces it? We restart it and it's fine. So that means for you, you need to remember to save this to your flash drive or email it to yourself or Google Docs, whatever, or you're going to lose it. I open Word and I just want to select blank document. And in this blank document, I will go up to the top file menu and select Save As. Save it to my flash drive or desktop, whatever. But again, if you don't save it to your flash drive, it's going to delete as soon as the computer is restarted. And these rooms are very popular. These computers will restart from now until next week. I'm going to save it, and the name doesn't really matter, but what we're going to do here is competitor analysis and long tail keyword strategy. This is a variation of something that we do for our client. As I said, I teach this and I do this for a living. Our company, when we get hired by a client, we have to do this competitor analysis. They want to rank better on search. They want to get more clients. Well, we need to know the competition. So we do a version of this. One of us on the team, like Sharna, for example, sets aside some time to do this, what I'm about to show you, and then puts together a report, and we present it to the client, and then a strategy, which we'll talk about next time. And then we set upon the challenge of ranking and doing SEO and social media and all of that. So you want to save this file. At the top, I'll just write competitor analysis, keyword. And here's where you're going to start to think about what are the keywords that define your company. What do you want to get found for? And my activity here has, we're going to do it two ways, the old way, the new way. It's still valuable to search with a plain old keyword to see what's working for the competition. So I often use just this fictional company, Victor's Bakery. So I'm going to do a competitor analysis for my company, Victor's Bakery, and for the keyword, bakery. I'm going to search on Bing and Google. We won't have time for both, but you would want to do this searching for both Bing and Google. I'm going to search Google first for bakery, that keyword, and then I'm going to do what my handout says. I'm going to check out the competition. You can, of course, if you've got a real business, do it for real. And this is not any homework. Don't need to turn it in or email it to me. I won't give you a grade. A+, okay? You get an A+. You did a great. But if you do want me to look at it in detail, I can look at it. My handout says, okay, go to a search engine and plug in a simple keyword from your topic. For the first page of results, write the title and description from each site. Click on three of them. Write notes on what each page features. For example, when was it updated? Does it have a blog? Is the design modern? Is the site mobile friendly? What do you like about it? What don't you like? You might not have the language of a web designer. That's fine. What do they say about art? I don't know what's good, but I know what I like. So the same thing here. We're going to look at the competition, and I don't know anything about web design, but I'm going to write what is good, in my opinion, what is bad, what I didn't do, what they're doing. We're going to check out the competition, reconnaissance. So I'm going to go back to Google. I'm going to do the basic keyword search, bakery. I'm not going to get fancy with any other special keywords. And what I want to do is avoid any results that are clearly ads. In theory, these right here shouldn't be ads, but I'm still going to skip them. I'm going to skip all of these guys. And I'm going to look, and I'm going to see, and I'm also going to skip, you know, the review sites and the ranking sites and the articles. I'm going to try to find results of real companies. And with that basic keyword, you're going to see less than you thought. Because here's a couple of Yelp results. Here's the 25 San Diego bakeries we love from the Union Tribune. Here's two GoGuff bakery workers quit over House Bill 2, etc. I'm going to skip all of that. I want to find a real result. And I found one so far right here. Edelweiss Bakery. So here's one that I found. And what I'm going to do is compile a list of as many as I want real results. And here's why I'm saying let's do it in Word or Google Docs. Because you can select this little chunk here and copy it. I want to take that. I want to copy that because that's valuable information that I'll explain in a moment. I want to select that result and then go back to Word. And let me show you this trick if you don't know it. If you simply do Control V or paste, it brings it in like that, but I don't want it like that with colors and highlights and all of that. I just want the text. If you go back to Word and right click and select paste option, keep text only, it'll bring it in without the colors and the bold text and all of that distracting stuff. I just want the text. So that Control V trick to paste won't work. You do have to right click and select from paste option, keep text only. So it brings it in as plain text. And the first bit here is the page title. You will see that we can edit that. You will see that it is valuable to edit it. It's one of the many signals that the search engines will look at. Edelweiss put in the name of their business, which has bakery in the name. So my keyword bakery is right there. And they put San Diego up on their title. Do you want to do that? Do you need to do that? Maybe. But that's the first impression. That's the first thing people see when in the search results. That page title. What might be valuable to put there depending on your business. Again, you can't really do SEO as one size fits all. You've all got different kinds of businesses that have different needs for SEO. This particular business was valuable for them to put in San Diego into their title there. Yours may or may not need it. Maybe I sell my products throughout the US, so I wouldn't need to put the location. But maybe I sell products like Victor's Bakery on Main Street. So in my case, I might want to put the location in the title. How to do it? We'll get to that later. We're just seeing what the competition did. Then a result here of their address, the URL, edelweissbakerysandiego.com. They have the keyword bakery in the title, and they have San Diego in the, I'm sorry, they have bakery in the address and San Diego in the address, and then their name, which is hard to spell for most of us. But it's got those keywords in there. And then a description. Edelweiss Bakery in Rancho Bernardo, a full-service European bakery, family-owned and operated, specializing in European-style baked goods. Wedding, and then it cuts off. There is a limit to how much you can write in that spot. Let me make a note here. This is the site title, also known as a meta title. This here is the site address, also known as URL. And this is the site description, also known as meta description. And then in the old days, when you learned SEO in the old days, and maybe some you know, gray hat or black hat companies might tell you, don't forget your meta keywords. We don't need meta keywords like we used to anymore. That was rife for abuse. There is a way on our website to also put in a bunch of keywords. We don't really need that anymore or want it. The search engines now really consider that gray hat, and in many cases actually black hat. If you just put in a bunch of keywords into your site as a list, that's not good anymore, because spammers do that. If you walk like a duck, talk like a duck, you're a spam duck. So these are the ones we care about. You don't really have to care about meta keywords anymore. You need to care about meta description, your address, and your title. A note about the address, about EMDs. Not EDM, that's something else. EMD. This is exact match domain. Not necessary. What this means is your domain name doesn't have to exactly match the keywords anymore. It doesn't have to exactly match what people are searching for. I want to find an affordable restaurant in San Diego. I'm not going to get a website called affordablerestaurantsandiego.com. Spammers do that. Search engines have huge databases of all of these websites, and they've seen 90% of websites that have these EMDs now are spam websites. And I just picked a random number. But most websites nowadays that have an exact match domain like that are spam websites. You may have a website that is exact match like this, but it still didn't hurt them. I'm not saying if you've got an exact match domain, you're never going to be number one. I'm just saying it's one of the many things the search engines look at. And if you haven't built a website and you're thinking about getting a website, you don't have to beat yourself up by getting eastlakedrycleaners.com. Someone probably already took it, like a spammer, and they want to happily sell it to you for $500. $2,000. Don't worry about it. Spend that money to build a good website and do SEO. I could be any kind of name, and with all of the SEO we'll be talking about, we'll deal with the name, any kind of name, which is quite evident right here. Twigsbakery.com is twigs.org. No semblance at all about that it's a bakery if I only see the address. No matter. Twigs.org, oh, they're clearly a bird-watching expeditionary tourist spot, right? They're a coffee shop in this case, a bakery. They're both. But here, they don't have an EMD. It doesn't matter. So I'm going to copy that and put it in my notes. And I'll make a note. Does not have the keyword in the URL, in the address. Not necessary anymore. Because before you heard about it, before it took over your life, what the heck is a Facebook? Before you heard about Twitter, what's Twitter? Before Google, what's Google? What's a Google? Isn't it a mathematical number? No, actually that's a Google. Google, how do you pronounce it? So all of these websites out there with these weird, interesting Web 2.0 names, Flickr, Twitter, Behance, Dribbble, you know, all of these websites out there with these weird names. Slack, Instagram, you know, what are these things? These names don't matter because of what you're building, because of your content and your authority and your longevity. The blogging that you do, the tweeting that you do, the content that you're creating that's making you famous, authority, and you're doing it for a while. Longevity, and that's why twigs.org is second place, which is still very good. I want to be number one, but I'll take second place on page one. I'll take number 10 on page one. It's still page one. But it might be hard to crack number one because of all the other stuff that's around there, the articles and the recipes and the Wikipedia and everything. And the third result is the bakery. This one's got an updated... No, this has actually got an outdated event, October 17th. That's why they're third place, perhaps, compared to the other ones. But I will paste that one in. I'm just compiling a list of results, and I can do as many as I want. When we do this for a client, we try to do 5 or 6 or so. Here, I'm just going to do 3 for the moment. I'm copying and pasting in their, this is, you know, their first impression. This is what I see first off from a sea of results. And I'm going to make a note. I'm making notes. What am I seeing? All of them do have the keyword bakery in their title. Edelweiss Bakery, Twiggs Bakery, The Bakery. They're all saying San Diego also. Well, that's telling me, should I be putting in my location if I need it? I'm also San Diego based. Should I put San Diego? I'm seeing here I don't need to have those keywords in my address. These guys are thebakerydesigncollective.com. Twiggs is a boutique bakery specializing in cakes for all occasions, weddings, birthdays, parties. We have 2 cafe coffee houses in the university. And then it cuts off, probably in the university area. And then the bakery. The bakery will be participating in the Open House San Diego event Saturday, October the 17th, 2015, an architecture and urban design event hosted by the San, and then it cuts off. We don't have a lot of space for a soliloquy here. You want to put the most important stuff there. Let's say all 3 of these interest me, and I want to order right now, as soon as possible, that wedding cake that I forgot to order. What would be very beneficial for me on this little chunk of info? Phone number? Maybe a phone number, some contact info? None of these have a phone number. Nothing's to stop you from putting a phone number in your description. We'll see how to do this, of course, later. We're talking about the theory, the practice. We'll get to that. But I'm going to make a note here. None of these, none have a phone number. Maybe in your case, some of them do. But none have phone number. That's giving me an idea. This may be how I could get better than my competition. I'll put a phone number on mine. That way, never mind that they never clicked. But they saw that little blurb, and they need, you know, one-day cake decoration. Call right now. And that phone number in there. Never mind that they didn't click. There's the phone number. It's better. They called. I made the sale. You could put your email there if you want. But you have a limited amount of space to tell people what you're about. Because if I just saw twigs.org, well, they're clearly some sort of, you know, forest recreation business. No, they're a bakery. They're a coffee shop, because I see it in the rest of the description. And this description would be a good idea to put in those keywords and the long tail keyword and so forth. Because what if I was searching for weddings? I'm seeing the keyword wedding appearing twice for the top 2 results. Weddings. Edelweiss focused on European-style baked goods. Maybe that's what I'm looking for. Again, I want baked goods, but it would be nice to maybe see if I can find that that old kind of, you know, German chocolate cake that Grandma used to make from the old country. These guys specialize in it. So maybe I'll call them up. This design collective, you know, they do events and open houses. Oh, that's interesting. I want to go get free stuff. I'll go to their open house. In a coffee house, university. So think in terms of what are people searching for? Who are you trying to get found by? This should help you stand out from the competition. What's the competition doing? What can you do better? What are they doing? What's working for them? I'm not appearing on the top 10. I'm on page 7. So I'm going to look at what pages 1 through 6 are doing. They're doing something right, because they ranked higher. This is not enough. We see some examples here. You might also take a look at searches related. That's a good idea to give me some keywords to think about. We'll look at other places for more examples. But maybe some of these might be interesting to me. Corner bakery, online bakery. These are some keywords I might think about using on my site if they make sense. I'm not telling you take these keywords and put them into your site. Obviously, bakery Encinitas doesn't work. Walmart bakery doesn't work. So take the keywords possibly that might be useful to you and we'll add them to your site. What we then further need to do, click on some results. You're going to swallow your pride. You're going to click on the competition. You're going to give them a hit. But you're going to go look at their website and you're going to see what's their website about. Again, I don't have the language of a web designer, but I have some possible ideas to think about. When was it updated? Because the search engines look at that. Does it have a blog? The search engines look at that. Does it have a good design? Search engines look at that too. A website that is easily manageable, navigatable. If your website is a mess with broken links, that's going to hurt you. I can't tell you. Make sure you have less than 3 broken links. I can't tell you that. I'm sure there's some algorithm deep in the bowels of Google that will tell you that. Bing will tell you that. But basically, all of these things you need to keep in mind. So I'll click on Edelweiss. I'm going to make a note, broken link. Maybe they're updating their design. Maybe just a hiccup. Okay, so it does come up. So then, here then, just getting a sense of what I'm looking at. I see a lot of great photos. These photos are enticing me. Not that one so much, but these look nice. Owned and operated by the same family since 1967. All of that stuff matters. All of that content and what's that?
Product overload, man.
No problem. See you next time. So what we're doing here is just to see all of this stuff that could help you get found, could help you make a connection. We'll talk into more detail about that next time, about reaching the audience in a more personable manner. But I maybe am more interested in, yeah, it's going to cost a little bit more, but maybe I want to get that wedding cake from here rather than another one from Walmart or Target or whatever, Vons, etc. Maybe because I want to support this local business from the same family since 1967. And I'm seeing these pictures, and I want to hire them. So it's all about your content. And no, you can leave that. You can leave it by itself. That'll be fine.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. So all of this content, that's long tail keyword stuff without having to be specifically saying it, because it's got, again, European bakery, cake shop experience, generations. It's got all of these different keywords. Custom wedding cakes. I didn't think about that. I just have wedding cakes maybe on my website. But if I see, as I see more and more of the competition, and more of the competition is using certain words, maybe that's what I'm doing wrong. Obviously, I'm not saying rip them off, but I'm saying get a sense of the zeitgeist, see what everyone's doing, and then figure out if it's relevant to you. What's relevant to me is I don't have enough pictures showing off my work. That's a really nice cake. It really does look like a glove. Some of them are better than others. You know, that one's a little dark here compared to that one. And I notice simply it's a much better picture because it's on a plain white background, whereas this one is on a murky gray one. Mine are on murky gray backgrounds. Maybe that's hurting me too. So that's telling me I might need to get better photos. Obviously, how you do that, I can't teach you that. But how to get better photos? Well, you take out your camera, set up a nice photo shoot, hire someone, put it into Photoshop. There's a lot to this. That's why it's, you know, a lot to keep track of. That's why there's professionals and such. But I'm seeing what the competition is doing. One thing that I would say that I would recommend as a design feature, as a designer, I have a degree in graphic design and I can tell you this, avoid using really ornate fonts for large portions of text.
And the texture back.
This should be here a plain font, a nice, more readable font, like plain old Arial. Like, it's funny, they use the kind of more basic readable font here, where that's where you would use the script ones, the nice looking, weird, interesting fonts. These big areas where the text is larger, that's where you want to use the ornate font. You don't want to use the ornate font on the basic text. That's harder to read. 8 to 10 servings, trimmed with diced pecans. So I'm going to make a note for you here. Design tips. Use ornate fonts for large text, which are technically known as headings. In WordPress, you can select a text and set it as a heading, and it gets big and bold and interesting looking. That's where you want to use your fonts, your interesting fonts, in headings, in small pieces of text. Use ornate fonts for large text in small doses. Use plain text for most body text, also known as body copy. The plain paragraphs, the place where it says, call us now, the place where it's got your about us info. So ornate fonts can go over here sparingly, but you want a plain text, Arial, Helvetica, Times, you know, plain fonts. So when they chose this font, they say, we love this font and it looks really good up here. It does, but then it doesn't look so good everywhere else. This is another little pet peeve here. That was a design tip. This is a pet peeve. Try not to use too many exclamation points. The point of an exclamation point is excitement. Three of them means you're triple excited. You don't want to do that. One exclamation point gets the point across. If you're a beginner, you want to use exclamation points a lot. You don't need to. So I'm going to say here, I don't think this is going to be detrimental to your SEO, but I'm going to recommend limit exclamation points. That's my quest for better design. And then also avoid italics plus bold. Italics is for emphasis. Bold is for emphasis. Now you've put emphasis on top of emphasis. Now you've diluted it and you've made yourself look like an amateur. Don't bold your italic stuff. Either bold it or italicize it. That's the point. Bold or italics, not bold and italics. And avoid those three exclamation points on your bold italic text. Yes?
I can't find it right now, but Google has a style guide, and part of their Google inspect elements now tells you contrast ratios. And some people would find a dark brown on that tan background to not be high enough contrast.
Yes. That leads us into another design consideration. So eventually next time we are gonna look at like the official Google manual, the official Bing manual for all the official things. We'll do that next time. But a good point of that is for design wise contrast. One of the most basic things to do in contrast is actually the hardest, because it's so easy for us to get carried away with design. When we've got something like this, even from a distance, you can't really read it, but this is good design because simply of the contrast. Black text on a white background. Newspapers, you know, they're in color, but the main text, the main articles are often black text on a white background. Good websites are also often black text on a white background. And you might say, oh, that's boring, I want blue on white. That's fine, as long as it's good contrast. Because you have to think in terms of foreground and background. Background, obviously, is the sheet of paper, white. Foreground is the text you put on it, or the pictures. So you always want to think in contrast. either light foreground plus dark background, or the opposite, dark foreground plus light background. So if you think about it simply in terms black and white, okay, light background is the white paper, and dark foreground is the black text. That's the best contrast of all. Very readable. Let's say you do, on this case, which is like a brown on a tan, some of this might be more readable than others, like
this is okay. It's a dark kind of a brown and a light kind of a brown. It's still dark versus light. This is starting to get light on light. That might be harder to read.
And I think there's some other examples that are worse throughout the site. Okay, right here, look at that pink text. That might be hard to read too. So always think about that, foreground versus background. And the short answer is light on dark. Here's a terrible one here, maybe.
This very light background is getting hard to read with that text.
Again, you might not be a graphic designer and such, just think about it in those terms. Dark on light. It can be any combination of colors, but once you're putting a light color on a light background, hard to read. Dark color on a dark background, hard to read. Light color on a dark background, good. Dark background and the opposite, good to read. Let me check out another one of these results, twigs.org. Right here. Very easy to read. That's actually not black, I think. It's like a very dark brown. That still works. One way to test if you've got good contrast is the squint test. Look at something, but then squint. And when you squint at something, you're cutting out a lot of the contrast, a lot of the light, a lot of the detail. And if you squint at something and it still looks, you know, differentiated, it's good contrast. If stuff is getting lost, it's bad contrast. So if you squint and if stuff kind of really blurs, it's bad contrast.
It's a different site, but it's still like that.
Yeah. Still very common. So all that design stuff does have some bearing because, okay, let's say the search engines don't care. People will care. Because the search engines really, deep down, they actually tell us, don't optimize for the search engines. Optimize for people. Because people are the ones that are going to see your sites. That's the point. Someone to visit here and buy something, not the search engine. The search engine's running 24 hours a day. It saw your website. But people are the ones that are going to come here and call that number or visit the place. So still, you want to design for people. And if I come to a site and I look at it, and overall, I like it. I like these green colors and such. I kind of think it's a little weird that they've got that tablecloth there. Actually, that's the side of a cake, but it looks like a tablecloth to me. Design-wise, there's a couple of things here and there that I don't like, and those things could be detrimental. People could say they could not, maybe they don't take you seriously. Why is that color weird? Why is that word trailing off? Why is there that misspelling? They might not take you seriously and go to your competitor, who might have less longevity but is gaining more authority because of a well-designed site and the content.
That looks like a template from a site builder.
Most likely, and that's okay. That's okay if you've got templates, as long as you, you know, customize them and make them look nice and so forth.
But yeah, this is a common sort of template design.
One way for me to make it interesting, let's say this was my site, you know, I might want to go in actually, and for some reason I don't think that weird graphic there works. So what if I had taken it out?
It's a WordPress template.
So what about that? What if I don't need to fill in every part of my design? Then what if I center that? Now, right now, I just I hacked into their code and I just changed their website. But what if I what if you think about that? Do you need to fill every inch of your site with content, with design and widgets and all of that? Not really, probably. So I'm making these notes over on Twigs. Don't like the weird, ghostly, floating cake at the top right. So I'm looking at the good, I'm looking at the bad. You'll probably be able to find plenty of bad about your competitor, but also be able to take a step back and see what are they doing right? What are you liking? What can I do, and better? So this is something that we do for the clients. When we did a rebranding for one of our biggest clients, we did this. Sharna did a bunch of research of competition, and you might be shocked to see that there might be shocked to learn that there's a lot of Mexican food restaurants in San Diego. So she did a lot of competition analysis and focused it down to several of the big ones, and then she did this and looked at it and came across that a lot of the competition had logos that featured an animal. A lot of these Mexican food restaurant competitors had a little animal in the logo. So did the client that we got hired for, getting lost in the crowd. So they're rebranding, we redid their logo. And we redid their logo to focus on one of the ingredients of the food. So now the logo features this plant, rather than yet another logo that has another animal. And you know, I'll talk about examples of our clients as time goes on, but this is the competitor analysis. We wouldn't have known that or realized it or thought about what to do about it without checking the competition. That's the old way. Do that as much as you want. I suggested here three. I did it just for Google. You want to do the same thing for Bing. You want to go on Bing and you want to go find other results besides the ones you got on Google. You're going to see the same results eventually, probably. You want to find different results on Bing and do the same thing. Check out their site, good and bad, pros and cons, what do you see, what don't you see. One thing that popped into my head here that might be useful for you, one thing that you want to avoid, don't make graphic text. I'm not saying don't make your logo into a graphic, I'm saying graphic text like here. This phone number to me looks like text, but to Google looks like a picture. It is a picture. This is a downloadable picture, it's not text. You can quickly tell what's text and what's a picture if you try to select it. This is selectable plain old text. I'm trying to select that text right there. Let's say I want to copy and paste it. Nope, it's a graphic. You want to have plain text for these important elements, like a phone number, for a couple of reasons. One is that the search engines, they're getting smarter and smarter, and they're able to look at a graphic and analyze it. But let's say we feed this picture into Google, it might be able to tell that it's some kind of wedding cake, but it's not going to be able to tell at all that this is a German chocolate cake with gold leaf and all of that. It doesn't know, it can't tell that. So the search engine doesn't know as much as it can about your site. What about this right here? You know, it'll think, oh, giraffe. It doesn't know that it's a cake of a giraffe. It might think it's a stuffed animal of a giraffe. And what's worse is that, let's say it looks at this and it can't analyze that text. Now the search engines are getting better at text rather than graphics, but here's a big detriment. I'm on my mobile device. I visit this site. I see a phone number. Do you notice oftentimes you can go on your device and tap a phone number and call it? I will not be able to do that with a graphic. It's a graphic, it's not a phone number. So if someone visited twigs.com on their mobile and wanted to tap that to call, it won't work. Okay, I'll tap and hold it and select it. I can't do that either. It's a graphic, not text. So my tip here is make important text into text, not a graphic. So Twigs needs to fix that. Or they might have it elsewhere within their design, but they need to fix it so that that graphic is no longer, that text is no longer a graphic. The third reason why it's so important to use regular text as much as possible is also for accessibility. It may sound odd, but did you know that people that are completely blind can still use the web? You think, well, how can such a visual medium be used by people that don't have visual faculty? The way that's done is that people would have a special software or computer that reads them the website. I visit this website, I'm blind, my computer reads to me. Link, home, link, Adams Avenue, link, University Heights. And then it reads, Twigs Bakery and Cafes, our bakery's mission, blah, blah, blah. It reads it to me. And I have a special keyboard that I have memorized that I want to click the third link, so I press a key on my keyboard. I can't see it, but I know the computer told me the third link is a wedding cakes link, so I hit my keyboard. I don't need to see my keyboard to use it. But when the screen reader software gets to a graphic, all it can really say by default is graphic. You can't say what's in it. It's not smart enough to say picture of a giraffe cake. Unless I specifically go in and add alt text, which we'll talk about later. But let's assume the screen reader doesn't know what the picture is until we tell it explicitly. So that graphic up here has a phone number that I would love for my blind readers to know that they can call me. But it's a graphic and I didn't optimize it. I didn't add alt text, so they can't. They don't get that notification. It just says graphic. Maybe someone did add in the alt text logo, which that's worthless too. Logo, who cares? There is a phone number there that people would care about that was not optimized. So we're going to wrap up very soon, but the second part of the assignment would be, okay, now you would do this with the long tail keyword strategy. Now you would search for terms that are more detailed, such as wedding cake specialists in San Diego, not just bakery. Or maybe I would search for, you know, gluten-free, vegan-friendly bakeries. You know, I'm going to get specific. This is what I need, so that's what I'll search for. That's what the second way to search for is, specifying, long tail. Notice what I say here. In a clean search engine, search for a long tail keyword for your niche. That little note, if we scroll down here, note. A clean search engine is one where you have reset your web browser. I recommend cleaning out all the cookies and browsing history before using the search engine. This will give you more accurate results. I get people coming all the time to these classes that say, I'm searching long tail keywords at home and I find my site. I go to my friend's house, I search the same long tail keywords and I don't find myself. I come here and I search those same keywords and I don't find myself. Why? What's happening is what they said. They are searching on their own computer those keywords. They're checking themselves out. They're searching themselves. And these web browsers, the web browser's not trying to hurt them or hinder them or trick them. These web browsers, Chrome and Firefox and Safari and Internet Explorer, all of these are a tool for me to visit a website. And I often visit my bank over and over, and my email over and over, and I often search certain things over and over. So it's building a history. It's saving cookies. It's building a profile. And so therefore, when I start typing something up here, it's going to start suggesting to me, and it's going to start guiding me towards things that it thinks I want. And that's going to be detrimental in my case now, but very helpful every other time when I want to go back quickly to Facebook, quickly to my bank, quickly this and that. But here it gets in my way. So what I'm saying here is to get the most accurate result, like someone that has never searched for you before, we need a clean web browser. A web browser where we've cleaned out the cookies and the history and all of that. And I'm recommending here, I recommend having a web browser just for these types of searches. If your main browser is Chrome, use Firefox for when you need to search. If your main browser is Internet Explorer, switch to Safari. If your main browser is Safari, get Opera. Basically, use a different web browser for this, because if you clean out your web browser, now you're going to lose your password to your bank and your history, and you're going to need to log into Facebook again. And people often leave themselves logged in all the time for convenience, but that's going to be detrimental for our searching. So I'm saying, okay, don't delete yourself out of your internet life. Get a different web browser. They're all free. Download them over at firefox.com, chrome.com, whatever. Get a different web browser. And on that one, look at the settings of how to clean everything out so that I can get the most accurate picture when people search. People then always ask, well, what about private browsing? That's useful too, but private browsing. If I'm on Chrome and I click on the top right corner, I have incognito mode. They call it incognito here. And what this is, it says pages you view in incognito won't stick around in your browser's history or the cookies or your search. Any files you download, however, will be kept. What this is saying is it's going to stop keeping track of your internet journey. It's not, however, forgetting where you've already been. So my recommendation is I need to learn, how do I delete the cookies on my browser? Search it. You need to find out how to reset your browser, and then how to go into private mode on your browser. They're all different. That's why I'm not telling you exactly how to do it. They're all different. But you need to find out how to clean out your browser, how to go into private mode, incognito mode, whatever they call it. Firefox won't remember any history for this window. But it still remembered when I went over to the college's website. So the double whammy is to clean out all your cookies and browsing history, go into private mode. Then that's a clean browser, where now I can search long tail keywords and get that accurate result when someone is searching for the first time. And that's why I'm saying do this in an alternative web browser than the one you usually use, so that there's no loss when you go here and clean it out or reset it or whatever. If you do that on your Firefox that you use all day long, now you're going to need to re-log into your bank. And I do know that a lot of people, you keep yourself logged in, and then when it's time for you to log in, you don't remember your own password. So don't delete yourself out. Yes?
If you're using, like, say, it's Mozilla for the first time on your computer, it's already clean, mm-hmm. but you have to go through a step to make sure your computer is...
When you download it the first time and set it up, it should be clean, but sometimes it does auto-import from the other browser because it's trying to help you. It's like, oh, you're using Firefox. You're giving up on Chrome. Great, let's bring your stuff in here. So I would still, just to be sure, clean it out and go into private. All the browsers have some way to do that. They're all a little bit different. How to reset Firefox. So this is giving me Yahoo results. That's fine, whatever. Top result, got my answer. So you need to look it up yourself. How do I reset Chrome? How do I reset Opera? Whatever browser you're using for this. And then you'll be able to do the second part of the activity here, which is now search the long tail keywords and build a list of competition and check out their website and answer some of these questions. Are they using social media? Do they have contact info? Does it have a feature your site doesn't? Do they have something your site doesn't? Maybe that's why they rank higher than you also. And all of that is to do competitor analysis, so that then you can compile a list of 10 simple keywords, 5 complete phrases, your long tail keyword, and then when we have time next time, we'll see, okay, let's apply them to the site. Let's build this keyword list, basic and long tail, and then let's create the content to get the authority to get higher ranking. So then that's why I said, do you want to do it the easy way or the hard way? The easy way is to get that credit card out. You're number one. The long way is this what we're doing. A competitor analysis, building keywords, adding them to the site, checking if it's working or not after some amount of time, refining our strategy. But this builds a foundation for long term. Whereas if you pay for it, when the budget runs out, little by little you start to drop. Because why would they keep featuring you if you've stopped paying? And to see if you're on the right track and such, that's the big lecture for next time. That's when we're going to set up our webmaster tools. That's when we're going to connect Google and Bing to your website. And it'll tell you so much great information. The traffic of where people came from, the time of day, how long someone stayed on your site, the breadcrumb of going from this page to this page to this page. All of that information, Google and Bing are compiling that information. I want access to that. It's free. We can get access. The catch is you need to bring your login information next time to connect Google and Bing to your website. And then that'll tell us, oh, it really worked when I tweeted this, and it didn't work when I wrote that blog, because it'll give you all your stats. Any general questions on what we've talked about today? By researching your competition, you are seeing what has worked for them. You are defining what sets you apart and what you have to offer in contrast to your competition. You will use your long-tail keywords throughout your site, such as in posts and pages, but you will also create content that fits the overall theme of your site. You will become an authority in the field you've targeted. You will create content on a regular basis, and you will spread this content throughout the internet. That's also a very dense sentence there, which we will expand upon next time. And then I mentioned here, check out chapter 1 of the book for quality content. Again, the book recommendations are on the syllabus with direct links if you want to check them out. Right there on the syllabus. We've got a lot to think about from now until next time. We're going to end up at this point. If you want a copy of the notes that I wrote, all these notes here, I'm going to put them into the network folder. And my competitor analysis here, that's not too much here, but I'm going to put that competitor analysis file into there as well. So in the network folder, my notes of today, and the competitor analysis that I wrote. Remember that all of these, everything that I'm talking about, I'm recording. In a lecture videos, and I'm uploading them. If you want access to those videos, send me an email. It's on the top of the syllabus. And I highly recommend, if you have the time for it, come this Friday. Come this Friday, 9:15 a.m. I think we're up in room 209, actually. And we've got day one of the social media class. And if you have the time for it, so guys, I'm still wrapping it up. And if you've still got the time for it on Mondays, if you want to learn to build a website, if you don't have a website, come on Monday, 12:30, this room, for the WordPress class. If you didn't get the day one class, I recorded it, so you can catch up on that. That's it for the moment. We'll have a little lab time until 4, and then we'll wrap it up and do it again next time. Thank you for coming.